One of the early stages of the therapeutic process, before treatment actually begins, is the process of formulation. This should be a collaborative activity involving both the clinician and the client, and it is focused on using the information that has been gathered through the assessment phase to understand why a client is presenting with a particular problem or set of issues at this point in time. Your formulation reflects your shared understanding of how the difficulties have developed and how they're being maintained over time. There are many different models that can be used in formulation. The behavioural model is grounded in the principles of operant conditioning and is known as a SORC analysis. The SORC analysis was developed by Canfer and Saslow in 1969. It allows the clinician and client to look together at the pattern of relationships between the antecedent stimuli and the problematic responses, and to understand why the responses are being maintained over time. The easiest place to start in looking at a SORC analysis is the response column. The response column contains the specific behaviours that make up the presenting problem. Some of the specific behaviours listed in this SORC analysis include verbally abusing mum, jabbing a corkscrew at mum, and swearing. The next place we go is the stimulus column. The things that are listed under this heading are essentially triggers for the problematic responses or behaviours. There are three subheadings. The first one is historical. Historical stimuli have a bearing on the likelihood of whether or not the behaviour is going to occur, but they don't directly elicit the behaviour. Historical stimuli can include something that happened earlier that day, but also things that relate to the distant past. For Jamie, the things that are under this heading are that he was a difficult baby, in his mum's words, and that he has a history of long-term difficulties with aggression and compliance. Now, the second heading is contextual. Stimuli that are occurring concurrently with the problematic response increase the likelihood of its occurrence, but don't directly trigger or elicit the response. One of the most relevant contextual stimuli for Jamie is his exposure to violent films. The last heading in the stimulus column is immediate. Under this heading, we find the stimuli that occur immediately or just before the problem behaviour and directly trigger its occurrence. For Jamie, the immediate stimulus is that his mum asks him to do his homework. The second column refers to the organismic variables. These are variables that influence the relationship between the antecedent stimuli and the response, and that are characteristic of the current state of the individual. Organismic variables may include cognitive functioning, drug use, emotions, and physical health problems. For Jamie, the only thing that is relevant here is that he struggles with regulating or managing his emotions. The next place we go is the consequence column, and what belongs here is what happens after the problem behaviour or response. It is important to think about this question from the perspective of each person involved in the interaction, in this case, Jamie and his mum, Christine. First, we have immediate consequences. These are the stimuli that occur straight after the problem response and that changes the likelihood of the response occurring in the future. What happens for both mum and for Jamie? Jamie is given multiple instructions to stop. Mum tells sister to leave the room in order to protect her. Mum tries to physically contain Jamie and wrestles the corkscrew from him. Mum then physically removes Jamie to his bedroom. Once there, she offers him a trip to the local store for shortbread if he can be a good boy. In the course of all of this, the original trigger for the behaviour, the instruction to do his homework, is forgotten. We also have to think about the delayed or longer term consequences of the problem responses. These are stimuli that are caused by the target behaviour in the longer term. They are not immediate consequences and they don't directly influence the likelihood of the problem response occurring in the future. Delayed consequences do, however, influence contextual variables that may be indirectly related to the recurrence of the behaviour. In our example, possible delayed consequences include mum feeling out of control and ineffective as a parent, and mum feeling fearful of Jamie, and a significant deterioration in the relationship between Jamie and his mum. The contingency column, our final stop. This is basically where we do our thinking in terms of the principles of operant conditioning, about how the behaviour or response and its consequences are related to each other. It's where we try to understand what function the behaviours are serving. In the short term, Jamie is getting a lot of attention for his misbehaviour. This extra attention is a positive reinforcement for Jamie's behaviour. Towards the end of the clip, having gotten Jamie to his bedroom, Mum asks Jamie if he can be a good boy. This feels like a well-worn routine. Jamie's voice quietens and he quickly agrees to be a good boy. When Mum then promises him that they can get some shortbread, Jamie's behaviour is positively reinforced because this is a treat food. From Mum's perspective, her behaviour of offering the treat in exchange for Jamie behaving better is also reinforced, but negatively, as his behaviour very briefly settles. In other words, stimuli that are aversive for Mum, namely Jamie's swearing and hitting, have reduced. This, however short-lived, is a good outcome for Mum. Ultimately, Jamie also misses out on having to do his homework, which is a good outcome for him and represents another example of negative reinforcement. Jamie has been both positively and negatively reinforced for engaging in a range of problematic behaviours and is more likely to do all of them again in the future. In terms of the longer term consequences, if Mum feels out of control as a parent and fearful of her son, this is likely to influence her day-to-day relationship with Jamie, and most likely in a negative way. Over time, the relationship between Jamie and his mum is highly likely to deteriorate, which will then become an important contextual stimulus for future problem behaviours.